morning.
My name is Mark Daniel. I am a county Watkins Extension Director and Board of Coach for Agents. Today's a much better day than yesterday. Yesterday morning, I was outside pruning some fruit trees, and it wasn't that much fun. But today's a better day. Today, we're going to learn about birds. We're very pleased. We have one of our master gardener volunteers, Dr. Lynn Mosley, here. So she's our local bird expert to answer your questions about spring birds. Thank you, Lynn.
Thank you, Mark.
Yeah.
It's so great to see everybody here. It's so nice to know there are this many people in Alamance County who want to learn about spring birds. I'm just thrilled because it's a great topic to share with people. And spring birds, strangely, represent a different category of birds that are with us now. And that's one of the things we'll talk about today. In fact, let me just go through what I'm going to hope to cover with you this morning. We birders know that birds vary according to the season of the year. The birds that are with us now, some of them will stay all year, but about half of them will leave, never to be seen again until next October. And that's interesting to know. It's interesting to know which species are which. But as a biologist, I also like to answer the question, why is this? Why do some leave and some stay? And why do they arrive at different times? Then I'll talk with you about some of the beautiful birds that come here during the spring of the year, some of which stay with us all summer, some of which don't. When they arrive, and what do they do once they get here? The third thing we'll try to cover are some specific examples of our summer resident birds and some spring migrants, and what you can do to attract these birds to your backyard. Maybe not to stay all season, but at least to stop and pay you a visit as they're passing through. And as you'll see, some of these are truly beautiful birds that it really pays to go to a little extra trouble to get them to come to visit you for a while. And then finally, I think it's important to take the last part of the morning to talk about what we can do to not only attract them, but also protect these birds. Because these birds, like all birds really, are facing a number of threats from different sides. And with a little effort on our part, we can do a lot to protect them, at least in our immediate vicinity. So let's start with the observation that bird populations are dynamic. What I mean by that is that they change as the seasons of the year change. And we birders divide them into four categories. And I'll give you some examples of each of them. Permanent resident species, they're here all year round. Winter visitors, as the name implies, just for the winter season. Non-breeding birds. Summer residents. And then birds that we see only as they pass through, going north or south, respectively. Some examples of each of these categories. I suppose the permanent resident species would be the ones that are most familiar to a general backyard casual birder. These are things like the northern cardinal, blue jays, northern mockingbirds, the chickadees, the titmice. All the woodpeckers except one species that we have in North Carolina are resident woodpeckers here all year round. There's one species, I'll talk about that a little later, that is a migrant woodpecker. Many of our birds of prey are permanent residents, including red-shouldered hawks, which adapt very well to suburban areas. You might have them in your neighborhood. Red-tailed hawks, Cooper's hawks, even bald eagles now have recovered enough to be considered permanent resident species. Barred owls are permanent residents. So a lot of the songbirds that you get at your feeder this time of year are indeed here all year round. Winter visitors. These birds typically arrive around the 1st of October, and they stay until March or April. A few of them linger into May. Those are the ones that breed way far north. So they're going to wait until there's a chance for the far northern parts of their range to warm up. But the yellow-bellied sapsucker, the first one on my list, is our only migratory woodpecker. And they're the ones that make those horizontal rows of holes in trees. And the reason they're doing that is to enter into the phloem tissue, that's in the cambium, where the nutrients, the food made by photosynthesis, which consists of sugars, will collect if they drill into the tree just that far. And by making a little row of holes, it gives them several different vessels to tap into. Then they'll go away and they'll make some holes in another tree, and then return and just follow the route that they have established and eat the sap, which is why they're called sapsuckers. But not only that, the sugary sap attracts insects. And insects, of course, are important for protein. Birds need protein in addition to just carbohydrates. So they also benefit by consuming the insects that are in the little sap wells, as we call them. Other winter visitors include, for example, this is the dark-eyed junco, a seed-eating bird that likes to forage on the ground underneath your sunflower seed feeder. The white-throated sparrow, often seen together with the juncos, again, a seed-eating bird that forages on the ground. And the yellow-rumped warbler, which is an insectivorous bird, but if you provide something like mealworms or suet, will visit your feeder. They're not going to eat the seeds. They don't care for your black oil sunflower seeds. But if you provide freeze-dried mealworms, like we do at my house, or suet in one of those little cages, they're very happy to visit with you. But the birds that I'm going to talk about mostly today are the spring and summer birds, the birds that start to arrive about late March, early April, and all the way through May. And these are some truly lovely species of birds. Remember, they spend the winter in the tropics, and it often pays to be really brightly colored in the tropics because rainforests are dark places. And if you can stand out and kind of glow in the dark like this scarlet tanager, that gives you a little benefit. So they bring these colors back with them when they come through to North America and breed. Chimney swifts, yellow-billed cuckoos, the hummingbirds. One species of bird of prey, the broadwing hawk, is a summer resident. Flycatchers, vireos, and many, many species of warblers and tanagers, swallows, and so forth. And there are about 50 species in Alamance County of birds that fall into this category of summer residents. So they winter south of us, they breed in our area. And this one right here, this little beauty, is a prothonotary warbler. And this is a barn swallow, very common in fields, pastures, and around barns. The last category, and these birds are the least well-known in our area because as spring and fall migrants, the only time we see them is when they're flying from their home, their winter home in the tropics, north to their breeding range in the northern U.S. and Canada. Or in the fall, the other way around, they're flying from the northern North America down to the Neotropics, Central and South America and the Caribbean. Bobolinks, for example, this one right here. We have about a 1 week period of time in late April and early May when we have a chance of seeing a bobolink. They're birds of open fields. They like grasses about a foot tall or so. And if you're not out watching for them in that kind of habitat, that particular week, you'll miss them altogether until the next year. A lot of warblers, which Roger Torrey Peterson, the author of the first multi-million seller bird field guide, called the butterflies of the bird world because they're so colorful. These are insectivorous birds that breed in northern U.S. and Canada. And we just don't have the right habitat or insect populations for them here. And so they're, again, just passing through.
So when they come through, are they just resting?
And feeding.
And feeding.
Feeding up for their next voyage. And they can fly 200 miles a day, Steve. They don't weigh an ounce. So they need to carry with them food that they've converted into fat in order to make that next day's voyage. So they're very happy if you have some trees in your yard that provide caterpillars, which have both protein and fat, so that they can beef up before their next flight. So we'll ask the question now, why is there this dynamic movement of birds? Why don't birds just find a place and stay there all year round?
Weather.
Good question, good answer, but wrong. And I'm so glad you said that because it gives me a chance to explain why it's not cold weather that makes birds fly south for the winter. Somebody did a study of chickadees in the north in the winter. Now, chickadees happen to have a far northern range where they can actually overwinter in Maine. And again, a little chickadee weighs, let's see, probably about 12 or 13 grams, which is a little more than a third of an ounce. Now get that in your mind, a little warm-blooded bird with feathers weighing a third of an ounce, spending the night when the temperature is zero, 10 degrees. Here's something cool about birds that you might not know. They have such thin skin, songbirds, that by taking a little bird in your hand and parting the feathers, you can actually see through the skin to the deposit of fat that they put down each day. At night, their little chest cavity is full of yellow fat under the skin. By morning, after that 0 degree night, it's all gone. They've all metabolized it in order to maintain their constant body temperature. So it's not cold weather that makes these birds fly south for the winter. What can it be? Yes, and the birds that migrate tend to have particular kinds of diets. For example, they might eat invertebrates like worms, or snails, or aquatic critters. Speaking of aquatic, perhaps they're fish eaters like this osprey. What happens when the water freezes? You can't get aquatic invertebrates, if we were talking about sandpipers or herons or egrets, and you can't catch fish because the water's frozen. So you have no choice. Your food supply is unavailable. You have to leave to go far enough south that the water is open year-round. The majority of our birds are insectivorous, like the warblers and the vireos and the flycatchers and the swallows. Insects tend to go into some sort of dormant stage during the winter, during the cold temperatures, where birds can't get to them. They're not little soft-bodied caterpillars crawling around on the leaves. So any insectivorous species has to fly south. And the tropics are a great place to spend the winter if you like bugs. Fruit eaters. Fruit eaters, depending on the fruit, can either be migrants or permanent residents. But soft, fleshy fruits tend to disappear or freeze so that they're unpalatable during real cold temperatures. So they're going to have to fly south. And that would include things like thrushes and tanagers and orioles. And then finally, nectarivorous birds, the hummingbirds of the northern hemisphere, all have to fly south for the winter because there are no flowers in sub-freezing temperatures to provide them with the nectar that they eat. So it's food that determines what birds do when cold weather comes. Okay? Well, let's assume then that our spring birds, which are about to arrive, are arriving almost as we speak, have flown up from the tropics and have arrived in our backyard. What do they do when they get here? Oh, not there yet. When they arrive. Here's where I'd like you to look at your handout. You notice that I have made you a handout after many years of recording these arrival dates and using data from other ornithologists as well, that breaks down the spring season by week, starting with the end of March and going through May, first week in May, which really ends the migratory season. And just by the mere fact that I was able to prepare this handout indicates that these things are predictable. So how is it that these birds are not just all arriving at once, but there's a sequence, a progression of who arrives when? This is due to two factors that has driven the evolution of this particular behavior, the situation of when birds arrive. One thing we call the proximate cause. Question in the back?
Yes.
Purple martin.
Purple martins?
Purple martins.
Yeah, they're here
and
now.
The neighbor, he's an old man. He had to hang down and broad in the middle, and it seemed like it was constant, but they don't know anymore.
No, purple martins aren't here during the winter. Sometimes starlings move into those houses, and they are permanent residents. So that might be what you're seeing. So the proximate cause of when birds arrive means that it's a stimulus, a particular stimulus that tells them, okay, it's time to leave Nicaragua and fly north to North Carolina. That is typically photoperiod. I'll talk more about that in just a minute. Amount of light and darkness during the day. But the second reason, and the more fundamental, or as biologists call it, the ultimate cause of when birds arrive, is what we would describe as an adaptation to the phenology, or the seasonal occurrence of the timing of when their food is going to be most available. Now think of what birds have to do once they get here. When does food need to be the most abundant for what they have to do to accomplish?
Breeding.
When they're breeding, when they have babies to feed, when they've got 8 baby chickadees in a single nest to feed, that's when they need to time their hatching of their eggs to coincide with the abundance of their favorite food source, whatever it has to be. And through evolutionary time, their departure from their wintering grounds in the tropics has developed to coincide with the point in the season when food will be most available for them to feed their offspring. And it may be fish for the ospreys, or it may be caterpillars for the chickadees, or fruits for the cedar waxwing. But whatever it is, this has all developed to correspond to that very important event of when food is maximally available.
I have sat at my window in the office, a 3-bay window, and seen tons of the cedar waxwings come and strip. They will take turns. They sit in an oak and will strip the hollies. And then I had a Washington hawthorn.
Oh, they like that too.
Yeah. But they were polite. They took turns.
I'm surprised.
Dan. How many, we're going through rather confused seasons. How many irregular years does it take before they adapt to that rather than waiting for the seasons to adapt?
It would take many, many, because over time, it's going to average out so that whatever amount of light and dark photo period they have evolved to use as their timing cue, over time, on average, will work to coincide with abundant food. But they can surely have years when it doesn't work as well. And I will add this. When you talk about the effect of climate change on wildlife, one of the greatest potential impacts for birds is that photo period isn't changing. Even though the world may be heating up, photo period isn't changing. What does that mean? Birds are arriving when they've always arrived here, but the insects are in fact temperature dependent. And so are the insects going to be emerging long before those baby birds have hatched? And that, for ornithologists and conservationists, is a real issue that is being investigated intensively right now. Some of the things that happen as a result of photo period, it's not just telling the birds, okay, it's time to fly north, but it's causing physiological changes. It causes fat deposition so that they can have the fat energy to fly 200 miles or more a day. It causes hormones to be released so that they shed their winter plumage and wear their bright summer breeding feathers. It causes certain hormones to be released so that the females can start producing follicles that develop into their eggs. And then it causes behavior changes. The desire of males to establish and defend a territory, to sing and advertise their territory, to start courting females and displaying with song and visual displays. And all these things are initiated by longer day length, photo period. On your handout then, you'll see that certain species tend to arrive earlier than others. And some of the numbers that you see beside certain species names, those are just my notes from over the years how if I've seen, say, some real early arrivals or some later arrivals, I've just made a note kind of for my own record-keeping purposes, but I thought you might be interested in this. And right now we're coming to the end of the third week of March and the beginning of the fourth week of March. And you can see that migration is really starting to pick up as March comes to an end. What would you say the peak of migration is in our area?
April.
Late April and early May, that's right. I was teaching at Guilford College for over 30 years, so this is really designed to coincide with the dates in Guilford County. But that's just one county to our west, and we are within probably a couple of days of Guilford County, if not almost exactly the same for a lot of the species. But every year I would give this to my ornithology students, and I always taught ornithology in the spring of the year because it was so cool to see these new birds arrive every week. After spring break, which was in the middle of March, every week we would have new birds to look for on our field trips. So I would post this on the lab bulletin board and we'd check them off as we saw them, so you can do that too. Sometimes the predictability has led to festivals celebrating the arrival of certain birds every year on the same day. Did you know that there is a turkey vulture festival in Hinckley, Ohio? Has anyone ever been to the Hinckley, Ohio Vulture Fest? I have not either. I feel like I should be obligated to do that. They have an all-day sausage and pancake breakfast, I understand.
Glad it's not vulture.
And perhaps you've heard about the swallows of Capistrano. Well, in Mission San Juan, Capistrano, California, on March 19th, they celebrate the return of the swallows. They're cliff swallows. They eat insects on the wing. They catch them in flight. Now here's a question. Do you think that every year there is not the first turkey vulture in Hinckley, Ohio before March 15th? I don't think so. I think if you were out there on the 14th, you'd see a turkey vulture or two. But you can probably be confident that by the 15th, they're going to be there and have a festival. So it's predictable. It's not absolutely exact. It's not set in stone. For example, there are reports on eBird, which is an app for reporting sightings electronically that are shared with anybody around the world. Someone has already seen a rose-breasted grosbeak in Guilford County. Now, find rose-breasted grosbeak on your list.
Fourth week in April.
And it seems to be a reliable account. He described a female rose-breasted grosbeak at his feeder. And you know what my response to that is? Birds fly. They can turn up at the wrong time and in the wrong place. In fact, that's one thing that gets birders going, is to try to see that rare bird, either out of season or out of location. Now, we'll talk about what birds do when they get there. So they've made their cross the Gulf of Mexico voyage, they've arrived in your backyard, and they recover from their migratory flight, they feed up, but pretty soon, those males are going to start to defend territory, to set up a territory that they will claim for their own for the purpose of the breeding season. Territoriality is a ubiquitous behavior in animals because what it does is to protect resources for the exclusive use of the territory occupants. We biologists think that it has developed as a result of what we call individual distance or inter-individual spacing. The tendency of animals to keep a distance separate from the next individual of their species. I used to tell my students, and I'll use Gale as my subject. Of course, I was the professor and they were, 21-year-old students, but I would say, now, if I came and stood over you like this during my whole lecture, that would be a little intimidating to most 18 to 21-year-olds, right?
75-year-olds.
Awesome. Well, we have a certain sense of comfort, a comfort zone, if you will, that keeps those starlings separated by almost, to the inch of space in between their neighbor. They're not snuggled up one to the other. And neither are they, 6 feet apart. They have a comfort zone of spacing that seems to work. And it's as if territory establishment takes that and expands it to include space for breeding, for nesting sites, containing food, shelter from the weather, shelter from predators, escape routes, and all those necessary features that birds need to survive and breed successfully. And what I just described is what we call an all-purpose territory, which is one of the most common types of territoriality. There are other types. There are some territories that are for nesting only. Think of colonies of penguins in the Antarctic. Their territory consists of, and I'm not talking about the emperor penguins that carry their egg on their feet. They don't have a territory. I'm talking about the ones that actually have a little pebble nest. Their territory consists of that area they can reach with one pecking distance to their neighbor. You know how they can reach over and peck their neighbor? That's the circumference of their territory. But all-purpose territories are very common for land birds in temperate zones. And it's established by the males using song and using visual displays. And that reminds me that I should mention that male birds of a species arrive first from migration. Why does that make sense?
By their territory.
because they are there to set up their territories, and they want that territory staked out before the females arrive. Because how are the females going to pick their mates? Who's got the good territory? Absolutely. Absolutely. And it's a good indication of the fitness of this male wood thrush if he's got a good all-purpose territory staked out, because it takes energy. It is a physical drain on an individual bird to establish and maintain a territory. And only the most fit of the species have the energy, the health, the vigor. They're free of parasites in order to maintain a good quality territory. And usually there's a range of territory quality ranging from absolutely excellent to just very marginal. And it almost always works out that the older, more experienced males get the best territories, and the young guys, the ones who are breeding for the first time in their life, they're at the periphery. They're out at the edge. You know, maybe they'll get a female if there are a lot of females available that year, but if there aren't, they'll just get a little practice and they'll be better next time. How many of you have experienced something like this? People think that cardinal keeps flying into my window or flying into the side view mirror on my car, and he won't stop. What is wrong with this bird? Is he crazy? Is there something physically, emotionally wrong that he has to fight his reflection? As the author of a textbook in biology once said, a robin's worst enemy is another robin. Because only another member of your species has the absolute same needs for the same resources that you do. In other words, only another member of this cardinal species would compete directly for the kinds of resources that that cardinal needs to survive and attract a mate. So the worst thing that can happen to a territorial bird is to have an intruder of the same species try to take over. And so they are programmed, they are hardwired to attack and repel invaders of their own species. And this cardinal, seeing his reflection in the mirror, that's a threat. That's a threat to his maintenance of that territory and his access to the resources in that territory. And he just can't turn it off. Actually, they eventually do learn, but it's a long learning curve before they figure out that this is a stimulus that is not a threat. So what do you do in a case like this?
Send their card.
Put it in the garage. You take a plastic bag from the grocery store. When you get out of the car, you just wrap it over there and make a little half knot, and that's all. If it's running into one of your windows or a glass door, you might need to put up a piece of cardboard or a newspaper. Just tape with masking tape a piece of newspaper. Usually it's a certain time of day when they are attacking their reflection, because the light determines when it's most mirror-like. They will eventually stop. I'd like to go on now to talk about some of the wonderful birds that do come to people's backyards during the course of the spring migration time. And some of these will be birds that you'll never see again during the course of the year, because they're only stopping by en route to their breeding grounds. And when you see something like that at your feeder, it is a delight. This is a male rose-breasted grosbeak. They spend the winter in Central America and Northern South America. The males are black on the back. They have prominent white wing bars, a white belly, a white bill, and this excellent rosy red breast patch. Now, the females look very different.
Oh, my God.
Except that they have the same shape. Grosbeak is French for large beak. And they are one of the birds able to crack the hardest seeds because of the large beak and the jaw muscles that power that beak. You don't want to get bitten by a rose-breasted grosbeak. It's like being bitten by a cardinal. I'm a licensed bird bander, and I do occasionally have to get cardinals out of nets and in order to band them. We catch them in long, very fine mesh nets. We take them out of the net, and during the process of removing them from the net, you know, you're holding them kind of up near the head in order to stabilize their head. And I describe being bitten by a cardinal as being pinched with pliers, somebody pinching as, or closing them as hard as they can on your finger. But remember if you've been bitten by a cardinal. It's easy to attract rose-breasted grosbeaks to your backyard if you provide sunflower seeds. They will eat the larger striped sunflower seeds. They'll also eat the smaller black oil sunflower seeds. In a backyard in a neighborhood that is fairly mature, that is, there's good vegetation cover, it's not, you know, a brand new barren housing development, it is very likely to have one of these come through and stay for a couple of days. There are not a lot of them spread out over all our residences, but there are enough that it's certainly possible. Indigo bunting. This bird is about the size of a sparrow, but it sure doesn't look like a sparrow. They are birds that like a variety of habitats, the edges of fields, and younger forests. Forest edges are typically their preferred habitat. During migration, they will stop at backyard feeders, and they will feed on seeds. This is also a seed-eating beak. Can you see how that conical, thick beak? That's a seed cracker beak, is what that is. This is the female indigo bunting, by the way. And if you look real close, you can see a little bit of blue feathers here, a teeny tiny bit there, a little bit in the crown, but she doesn't look much like that. They will prefer the smaller black oil sunflower seeds, and I always recommend that people scatter some on the ground because they, like most sparrows, are ground foragers as much as feeder visitors. And if you do have sunflower seed feeders, they don't really like the tube feeders, and you know what I mean by that, the plastic tube feeders with the perches that come out. They prefer a flat platform feeder or a hopper feeder, or on the ground, seeds on the ground. In addition to sunflower seeds, they'll eat the proso millet, they'll eat chopped dried fruits, chopped nuts, just a variety of things. Yes.
Lynn, we've gone to safflower seed instead of the sunflower, just to avoid the squirrels.
Uh-huh.
And does that, will they eat that too?
I don't know. I don't think they will, though. Because even, I don't know if you found this, that it usually takes birds a while to get used to making the transition from sunflower to safflower. And I'm not sure that they would. But it would be interesting to try.
Can you have just the female stop and by?
Yes.
Or just the male?
You
because
can.
They will migrate in different times.
That's right. That's right. There'll be a little lag between when the males come through and when the females come through. Another absolute beauty. This is technically a summer resident. It is technically not a winter visitor, which is pretty funny since Gail and Kurt have had one all winter long to my great envy.
She was there this morning.
She was there this morning, yeah.
Oh, wow.
So, in fact, I wanted to show you. This is for you, Gail Kurt. This is the range map of Baltimore Orioles. For some reason, they are showing up in North Carolina in the winter. But look, the tan is the breeding range. The yellow is when they're found in migration. It's the blue is where they're supposed to be in the winter. They're supposed to be in Florida, not in your backyard. Got lucky. But
you take flamingos in your yard? Yeah.
That's next year. This is a female Baltimore Oriole. You need to look at the field marks carefully so you don't confuse them with female tanagers. Unlike tanagers, whoops, the females have wing bars. They are kind of a brown on the back, two white wing bars, and the amount of yellow to orange varies. Look how this female has a dark head, and this is indeed a female rather than a young male. And orange on the breast and whiter on the belly. And the classic suggestion to attract orioles is to offer orange things, orange fruits, particularly oranges. Some people hang them from strings. Some people will nail an orange half to a tree. But the bird people, bird feeder people, have figured out that this is a way to make money by selling oriole feeders. This is a specialty oriole feeder. And it has sections for three different kinds of food. You would put sugar water, like you make for hummingbirds, except a little bit stronger, in the dish on the bottom. Then on the top, like this, the holes are so that the bird can get its tongue through to access the sugar water. The little depression cups here are for grape jelly. Some people swear that it has to be Welch's grape jelly. Don't quote me on that. And then you take an orange half, you pierce it down the middle with this hanger, and then you screw the hanger in so the orange half is facing up. And so you've got nectar, grape jelly, and an orange. And it's colored orange. And I have actually had a Baltimore Oriole come to my Oriole feeder, but I also had a rose-breasted grosbeak last year come to this, which is not in the books. That's not supposed to happen. Anyway, that's an Oriole feeder. And Gail, what did you use for yours?
Mealworm.
So, her Orioles never cared about oranges. They just wanted freeze-dried mealworms. And they've been coming basically all winter, right? Yeah. Wow. Was there a question?
Mary? That's a female?
No, it's not. That's a mistake.
I just wonder. I'm sorry.
I wondered if anybody would catch me. This is not a female. It was supposed to say Baltimore Oriole food, but somebody typed.
Ma'am?
But when it fans its tail, and it, you see that, it is just spectacular.
I was wondering, what is unique about her environment, her the bird habitat at her
place?
Yeah,
we'd all like to know. Mealworms, maybe?
Oh, okay.
But, you know, you live on near Shadow Brook, right?
Right.
Suburban.
Shrubbery and trees.
There. Shrubbery and trees. So they just got lucky, and they had the food available when the bird first came into their yard, and it was happy and it stayed.
Mm-hmm. We had neighbors spotted too.
And your neighbors have had them too, okay.
Do different species have different lifespans?
Yes, although, as a broad generalization, a typical songbird can live 6 to 7 years if it makes it past its first year of life. Bird banders are the ones who get the records on this because we know when a bird was banded. We submit our data to a federal depository of information, the Federal Bird Banding Laboratory, so they keep all this data for millions of birds that have been banded over the years. And if a bird is recaptured that I banned as a nestling, 15 years later, that's how we know how long it lived. It's hard to get that kind of date. And one of everyone's favorite summer residents is certainly the ruby-throated hummingbird. In the east, during the breeding season, this is the only bird that hummingbird that we have east of the Mississippi. In the winter, there are more hummingbirds around North Carolina than there are in the summer, but that's a small number compared to the number of ruby-throateds that we have here during the summer. Ruby-throated hummingbirds, they're also one of those birds that it's just amazing they can even survive. You know, they fly across the Gulf of Mexico when they're flying south for the winter and north for the summer. And you can't stop when you're flying over the Gulf of Mexico. And they might start out weighing, say, 12 grams, 11 grams, and when they get to the other side, they'll weigh 7 or 6 grams. Now they're 28.5 grams in an ounce. So that's a quarter of an ounce.
Do they make nests? Do they?
Out of spider webs and lichens and plant down. This is the female. She lacks the ruby throat, but she can have a little bit of spotting, speckling in her throat. And here's another way to help distinguish a female from a young male. You see the white tip to the tail feathers here and here, especially the outer tail feathers. The males don't have those white tipped outer tail feathers. Now what is this? What?
A baby?
This is an adult male. What's wrong with this picture? Actually there is red there. There's just as much red as on this one. It's the light. These colors are not pigments. They're called structural colors. They reflect light, but only when it's a particular angle that it hits the feather does it reflect in red. Otherwise, it's going to look black. And that's true for all hummingbirds. Their colors, especially on their gorget and their throat, are always structural, iridescence. This is a ruby-throated hummingbird without the proper angle of light to show the red. This is an opportunity for me to make sure that we're all on the right page for feeding hummingbirds. Hummingbird feeders come in all shapes and sizes. Here's one. This also would have the little brass hook. But all you have to do to make your hummingbirds very happy is to have a feeder with a receptacle or a jar is fine for the hummingbird nectar. 4 parts water to 1 part sugar. So I make about a quart at a time. 4 cups of water to 1 cup of sugar. And keep the leftovers in the refrigerator in a quart jar. Never use red dye. That's absolutely not necessary. Hummingbird feeders nowadays are red. That will attract the bird without having to dye the juice. In fact, it's harmful to use the chemicals in the dye in the hummingbird food. Remember, when you only weigh a quarter of an ounce, little teeny tiny amounts of chemicals can have a major impact. Your hummingbird feeder should be easy to clean, and especially during the hot weather. When we have 90 plus degree days, you really should change your hummingbird food every 2 or 3 days because it'll start to ferment or get bacteria in it or mold. So this is a nice, easy to clean feeder. The top just comes right off. This is not easy to clean. And I got this as a door prize, but to clean this, you would have to get a bottle brush that can get down in there, and that means it has to be kind of small, but it has to be big enough to clean the whole sides. And then this doesn't come apart. And the reservoir of the nectar down here is that's going to be hard to clean out and the mold that can grow inside there. So very pretty, but useless. I use it to show what not to do. Okay, I'll get a party.
Okay, I saw the round one you got in the store.
Yes.
And I thought, yay.
That's good.
It's easy to clean. Mm-hmm. And we only have like about five hummingbirds that they come like regularly. Okay. So what I found out was that there's one will fight the others off. Mm-hmm. They can sit there in the patio and watch. And so it's like one bird to that big feeder. So I found some smaller tubular ones that basically on the literature say they're supposed to go in like a window box type thing.
Yeah.
And so I've got hanging all down from the rafters of my patio, covered patio. And so now they all will sit there and watch and try to determine, you know, if they have their own territory.
Right.
But I thought the other one would be easier.
Yes.
But it didn't work in my yard.
That's an example of a feeding territory. And that is the type of territory that hummingbirds have. Before there were such things as humans putting up feeders, one hummingbird would defend one coral honeysuckle bush or something and wouldn't let any other hummingbird feed from that bush. So that's a feeding territory. But that's a good alternative. You just offer more feeders.
Lynn?
Yes.
It said put the feeders in the shade.
Yeah.
Does it, you know, like that full shade, or does it need full shade?
No, that's only really a factor in our real hot days of summer, because it just keeps that nectar from spoiling as fast as it would if we're in the full sun. Yes?
I have one more question. I have a whole entourage of songbirds that stay all year.
Mm-hmm.
They're here all winter. I'm talking like 20, 30. That usually are in my front. So when these migrating birds come through for just a day or two, are they going to be accepted to land and feed there with all the others? Or do I need to go back to another feeder to capture some of the migrating birds?
That's a good question, and the answer is you don't need to worry, because the seed eaters don't defend feeding territories.
Just one comment as a beekeeper, and the attraction of that sugar water to bees, don't overfill the container that you're feeding from, because you've got to approximate the tongue length of the bee. So if you keep it a little lower, you won't be attracting the bees.
Here's another thing that I have just learned from feeder manufacturers. You notice how the little flower-like things are red? They used to be yellow on all, and the yellow, it turned out, attracted the bees more.
Right. Yeah.
So that there's a transition now into fading, doing away with the yellow bird feeder flowers. Right. One of the best ways to attract and keep hummingbirds is, in fact, to plant native plants that are nectar providers for birds. And you have a handout that includes various ideas for feeding nectar-eating birds. I have to include the yellow-billed cuckoo here, because I don't know how many of you read Brett Davis's column, but he has learned recently about the existence of the yellow-billed cuckoo, and tells his story about being out in the woods with his forestry folks and hearing what he thought was a dog barking. And the forester said, no, that's a rain crow. And what the heck is a rain crow? You know, Rex's been around. He knows something about wildlife. So I thought you would be interested to hear the voice of the yellow-billed cuckoo. Imagine a hound baying in the distance. First, you're going to hear the EO. Thank you. sounded like a dog to you or not, but use your imagination. It is a very unusual call, and they're so secretive, you hear them much more than you see them. One of the neatest things about yellow-billed cuckoos is that they're one of the few birds that actually prefers fuzzy caterpillars like tent caterpillars. So often, fuzzy caterpillars are irritating. Sometimes it's almost like being stung, except stung is just a tactile irritation. Can be very painful to humans. And these cuckoos, which arrive around the fourth week of April, late April, they prefer those fuzzy caterpillars. They're beautiful birds. In the last few minutes here, let me just go quickly over three ways that I would like to offer folks to think about to improve the lives of birds in your immediate vicinity. And the first one is to plant native plants, not just for hummingbirds, but for any and all of our summer residents. The handout that you have is from Auburn, North Carolina, especially for the Piedmont region, and it describes the types of food and specific plant species that offer each type of food, whether it's plants that will grow caterpillars, essentially plants that butterflies and moths lay their eggs on, hatch into caterpillars, and caterpillars feed baby birds of all species. Plants that produce berries, seeds and nuts, and nectar. So use this as a guide, and there's much more information through the National Audubon website in Audubon, North Carolina. There are 400 species of native plants that Audubon has compiled into a spreadsheet that you can download, and you can choose according to your particular light and soil and moisture conditions. On other websites, you can find lists of the 10 favorite nectar-producing plants for hummingbirds. Second, it's a very sad picture. It really makes me sad to see this because I love cats. I have 3 cats. I love cedar waxwings. That's what that cat has caught. And we would all benefit birds in the neighborhood if we would keep our cats indoors. It's hard. Our 3 cats were feral. They came out of the woods. We adopted them, socialized them. There's still one that I can't bring indoors. He tore the screen out of a window one time in order to get out. So it's a challenge. But, you know, where there's a need, somebody will figure out a way to make money. This is a bird be safe collar. They say you put this on your cat and the birds will see it coming. I'll let you know how that works.
Where did you find it?
Online.
We used to tell our neighbors to put a bell on the collar. Yeah.
And that can help. Yeah. That's probably easier than birdies and bells, collars, whatever. One thing that research has shown is that most cat predation in urban settings occurs at night. And so even if your cats are out during the day, if you can just keep them indoors at night, that will go a long way. And this chart is from Audubon. You wonder how there are any birds left alive. Between 1.5 and 3 billion birds per year are killed by cats. That's a terrible tragedy. And cats not only kill birds, they also kill small mammals. Let me say again, I love cats, but they are just really danger to birds. And the third thing, and final thing that I'll talk about today, is to consider bird-proofing your windows. How many of you have heard a thud when a bird has run into a window? It certainly happened at my house. And this knowledge has resulted in a number of solutions that can at least reduce the mortality that bird strikes cause. Up to a billion birds die per year from window strikes. Now, this includes suburban homes, and it includes skyscrapers that are made of all this mirror-like glass in downtown areas. But there's actually more glass in residences than there is in city skyscrapers. So we homeowners are responsible for a lot. Here are a few quick suggestions. Many things that you probably already have can reduce mortality by window strikes. This side of the window has a screen. This side has no screen. What birds are doing when they fly into windows is they're seeing the reflection of the vegetation outside and thinking it's a straight path through. They don't know glass. They don't understand that concept. So the window screens will reduce the reflection, and also if a bird does fly into a screen, it's a little bit of a baffle. In the same way, curtains or drapes or shades or blinds can reduce the reflection. And you can see here that it's not 100% reduced, but it is reduced a good bit. Of course, the downside of this is that your curtains are closed and you can't look outside to see your birds. What's the good of that? Research has shown that there's such a thing as the 2x4 rule. If you think that you can put decals on your windows and prevent birds from flying into them, think again. You can, but there's a catch. There has to be no more than 2 inches between the decals if you're putting them horizontally in rows, or a minimum of 4 inches if you're putting the decals in vertical lines. So that if you put one hawk silhouette on a window, is that going to help?
No.
You know what it would have to be? That. These are options, but they have limited appeal to homeowners who want to use their windows. So there are other suggestions, and you can go online and find a number of these companies that sell things like bird tape. American Bird Conservancy, abc.org, is doing a lot of research on ways to mitigate bird strikes. And you can just peel that off and tape your window. To make an even less obtrusive covering for your window, two companies, Feather Friendly and Solex, make a bird safety film that follows the 2x4 rule. And you can put them, you can buy sheets of it, cost $10 for a 24-inch by 32-inch window, and or you can have it professionally installed. This was actually used at Duke University because students complained about a bird-killing building on the campus, and it's cut mortality by over 95%.
Wow.
Really effective. For commercial buildings, there's lots going on in research by companies trying to come up with alternatives that are both attractive, prevent bird strikes, and yet let people see through windows. This is what the bird's eye view of an outside window of a USGS, US Geological Survey building looks like. And this is what it looks like from the viewer's point of view. That's the same window. So we're making progress with glass or films to cover glass to prevent window strikes. So birds need our help. There's lots we can do. And I hope you see some of these spring birds and summer residents during the upcoming season, if spring ever gets here. My knowledge is most of my close-up bird pictures come from either Audubon or Cornell's Laboratory of Ornithology. Thank you very much.